Hi, I'm Linda Winter with Martelli Enterprises, and I also am with Winter Designs. That's my own line of templates that the Martellis make for me. Today I want to show you how to do a microwave bowl. You probably have seen these before. This is the microwave bowl. You hold it up by the corners that are now rounded. You stick the soup that's cold in the microwave, and when you have it roll and it turns around in the microwave, because the microwave bowl template has been created with a template that you will learn about more later, it's not going to spill. We've got consistent, accurate darts that we have here. They're the same length, the same width, so when this spins, it's not going to spill. It's also great for ice cream. Ice cream that's cold, this ice cream, imagine my hands aren't going to be cold and the ice cream stays colder longer. You might notice the difference between this microwave bowl template and this microwave bowl template. With the design of the template that I have here, I can change the dart height. And so what that gives me is something that holds a bowl that's a little bit taller. I'm going to pull over two bowls so you can see some other options. So one of the things that's really nice about the template is that it allows you to adjust for a taller bowl versus a shorter bowl. If you look here, it's a little bit taller here than it is here. I've got a much taller bowl here than I have here. So the template, when we take a closer look at it, will allow me to make something that hugs a taller bowl versus a smaller bowl. So bowls come in different sizes and different shapes, different heights. This one sits much shorter than this one. This is definitely much shorter than this. This is wider. So when I use a cozy like this, this here versus this here versus this here, you can see it kind of hugs. But when I grab this bowl is kind of loosey-goosey. It's in there flopping around. So when I use the template, then I can make this so that it sits higher. Again, not a big deal. You can customize if you want to. If you're whipping 10 of these out, then I'd say, who cares what size the bowl is? Just make them all the same. So the traditional method to make a microwave bowl cozy is to have cotton. Cotton fabric, cotton batting, and cotton thread. Now, honestly, I don't know if this is cotton thread or not. I just grabbed some thread that we had here in the store. So get some cotton thread. Why do we want cotton? Because it's in a microwave and we don't want any fires. So I'm not going to be blamed for any fires that you have going on in your home. So when you grab some fabric, think about getting some cute fabrics. I've got some watermelon fabric here because this bowl might be holding watermelon, not just the ice cream in the summertime and not just the hot soup. So this would be really cute. This is your backside. This is the inside. If you're eating ice cream or the candies, because it can be a candy bowl too, some cute candy fabrics. This is a good background fabric here. Today we're going to work with some tomato soup kind of stuff, so you'll see me with this. One of my fabric lines, Tim Holtz, if you all know Tim Holtz, this is part of his fabric line, so if you're going for that retro vintage kind of a look, then that's an option as well. So cotton fabric, cotton thread, cotton batting. So what do we normally do? Normally, if you read any of the directions online, they're going to tell you to stitch here, and then we make our darts. Our darts. When we have the darts, the problem is we're going to mark our darts, and that dart here might not be the same width. The length, the width, and being perfectly centered makes this microwave bowl turn wonderfully in a microwave. If those darts aren't perfect, then that bowl might not turn perfectly. So originally, when I came up with the idea to do this, I saw projects online and I had my round offs. In the first video that I did with the round off, I had that yellow microwave bowl cozy and I showed the microwave bowl with the round offs. So this was a way to do that. This radius here versus this radius here versus this radius here versus this. There's four radiuses on the small. There's a medium size and there's a large size. Those are the round offs. So if you own the round off, you could do this. And when you go to cut, we'd line this up. And because I'm left-handed, I would cut turning the template. And what that allows me to do is round that off. That's one way to do it. And that was the way that I had done these microwave bowls before. The rounded corner gives it a little bit more sophistication, if we could say that when we're talking about microwave bowls. So the idea of the round off, that's a great concept. But I had ladies in Pensacola, my group of ladies, hi, you guys told me to come up with a way to make it more accurate, more consistent, faster, easier. I have a rule, it better be good, it better be fast. So this is the template that I came up with.
The darts here are designed by holes that were cut by a laser machine. This was created on a CAD program, so it's accurate, it's consistent. And because this was cut by a laser machine, it's accurate, it's consistent. Our get a grip material on the back that grabs the fabric. So if we think acrylic, imagine just using a ruler, that ruler would move on us. So this microwave bowl koozie, all of our templates have that get a grip material. That's gonna grab. So now when I go to cut, I can cut turning the template as I go. So that makes what you're doing, again, faster, easier, more accurate, more consistent. So these dots, the dots that are here, that's where we're gonna put a pen and mark for our darts. What that allows us to do is have the darts perfectly in the center on all four sides. The length is gonna be exactly the same, and they're the same width. So back to this versus the other one. If you wanted to make one taller for those taller bowls, then when we mark this, I'm gonna show you a little trick so that we extend the length of the dart. So let's take a look. All right, so I wanna show you two different ways to cut. And I'm gonna backtrack for a minute and just mention, I have written directions. The written directions are on my website. My website, www.winnerdesigns.com. Winner as an opposite of loser. For all of those of you that know me, you know my little pun. So the website, when you go to extras, winnerdesigns.com/extras, you'll see at the bottom written directions for the microwave bowl, for my coffee cozy, for my roundoffs, for my baby bib, for my burp pad, for a bunch of other things. So written directions will tell you all the tools that you need and step by step with some really good pictures too. So this video is really to focus on the steps but also how to cut. So I want to go over two different ways to cut. If you know the Martelli rotary cutter, we roll forward. If you don't know the rotary cutter, Valerie has done a really great video. So I want you to go find her video on Martelli's website, martellinotions.com. She's going to show you how to use this rotary cutter, because if you've used other rotary cutters, you're used to pushing down. Here we're going to push forward. So today I want to talk about two different ways to cut. All right, so it's easiest to do two pieces at once. So I've got my back and my batting here, and then for my next, I've got my top and my batting. So it's easier to work with one section by itself. So I wanna show you the first way to cut. We're gonna do around the curves the first time, and then the next time we're gonna be cutting off, so you'll see the difference. So as I go to cut, I'm gonna start cutting and I'm gonna move my template as I go. I stop every now and then just to reposition my rotary cutter, but I am following along that edge. As I go to cut, I just keep cutting and I'm following along that edge. And then I'll get back to where I started, and then I'll see if I need to go back and cut anything again. So that's basically where I started. And you can see here, I'm just gonna go cut, and then I got everything else. So that's the first way to cut. Let's do the second way. All right, so if you're not so confident with your cutting skills, then the easiest thing to do is just cut off. And then we'll turn, and then I cut off. What I'm doing basically is I'm going a little bit along the edge, but then I cut off. And then I turn the template. Because this fabric stays with the template, unlike your paper templates, unlike the acrylic templates, unlike the Mylar templates, when I go to cut, I'm moving that template, but here, when I get to the curve, I had straight, now I'm gonna cut off. So I basically am just doing kind of as close as I can, and then I just scoot. So I'm gonna, again, go off a little bit, and I turn that template, and now I can go straight. So when I get to this curve, again, I'm gonna cut off, I turn it, I cut off, and now I can go straight. And then again, I cut off, turn the template, cut off, and I'm pretty much done. So that's version two. All right, so let's talk about the next step. This is why the template is so good, and again, why I have to thank the ladies in Pensacola that pretty much twisted my arm to make this template. These holes that are here, again, perfectly centered, the same width, the same length. So how do we mark these? We can use a regular old pen. A pen, you can use one of the invisible marking pens, but right now we're working on the batting. So this isn't gonna show. So I have a regular old ink pen and I'm just gonna do a dot and a dot and a dot. Notice I'm just kind of swirling around, following that edge. I've marked these, so I'm gonna turn this here and mark this one. So I'm just kind of going inside there and getting down to that batting. If you're using one of the Sharpies, realize that Sharpie may go through your fabric onto your mat. So if you're going to use a Sharpie, a permanent pen, anything that's more serious than a regular old pen, stick something underneath your fabric in between your mat. Ask me how I know to tell you to do that. Go home and look at my mat and you'll see. So once I've marked all of those, then that gives me my dots. So now I want to line these up. We're going to use the template as our edge. So I'm going to take this template and line up to those dots and then just draw a line. This is going to be my sewing seam. And I'll turn this and I draw a line and put it where you can see it. And I would continue on. So we'll do all of those. When you're finished with that, you'll have two that look like this. Ignore this for a minute. Two that look like this. So this is our front and the batting, and then our back and the batting. So let's pretend that this has those marks all done. So we want to now talk about doing the next seam. So here's the deal. We need to go from edge to edge, from here to here, to be able to sew on this seam. If you've got a walking foot, then working on this side, like I've got my lines here, will work just fine. But if you have a sewing machine that has any issues with batting versus cotton, batting stretches when you're sewing, when this is on top. So I recommend that you mark on the back side. So how do we mark on the back side? That's when you could use an invisible marking pen. I will tell you, all of mine I've done by marking on the inside, but it gets a little puckery sometimes here. So I'm going to tell you to do differently than me. So Martelli's have come out with a marking pencil, not a pen. And this is pretty cool. This comes with four different colors. And you can see here these pencil leads. And it already has a point to it, but you can sharpen this as well. You can erase this, but more importantly, you can use water. And I just tested this out and it does work. So we're going to use this today for our sample. So we're going to pretend that these are all marked just like this here, and we're going to go to the back side. So what do? If you got a ruler, this no slip ruler, which I love, you can see here I'm pushing on this thing doesn't move, but any ruler will do. Of course, the Get a Grip is going to make this be a whole lot more valuable. So we're going to flip over and we're going to fold. I'm looking at my edges here, I'm looking at my edges here, and I give this a nice little press. If you're a risk taker, you can just press this with an iron and then hope that you can follow that seam. I'll tell you, I'm pretty much a get her done person, but I'm not going to do that for me. I've just found out that marking this makes all the difference. So we're going to again line this up, give this a good little press, and this press is just temporary because as soon as I open that up, I'm going to place that ruler down. And what do we want to do? We want to draw a line. So I'm going to use this pencil and I'm going to draw. Now this is my sewing line. We're going to sew this before we do the darts. And I don't know if you can tell, but I've got a blue pencil lead in there. And we would do the same thing. We're going to fold this way, give it a good press. We place our ruler and then draw that line. So we would do that on both of these. I've got this done on the inside. Again, this is how I've done it. I recommend the back side so you don't get all those puckers. If you've got a walking foot, it doesn't really matter. But if you don't have a walking foot, it will make all the difference. All right, so we've done that. We're going to go to the sewing machine and we're going to stitch from point to point. Point to point, point to point. When you've done that, that turns into something like this. And my little sample that I have that's showing just this done is missing. So we're going to go to here and pretend these darts aren't here. So we've stitched, we've stitched. What that allows you to do is get those two layers together. So when I've got my two layers on the top and my two layers on the bottom, my batting is basically adhered to the backing and adhered to the inside. So that gives it a little bit more stability. When this thing goes in the washer and dryer, I want it to have still some shape. So we've stitched that together. So that's our next step. Once we've done that, then we're going to take our darts. I'm going to fold this in half, and I'm looking here, and I want to look on the other side, and I want to be able to see that this is lined up with this. And then I come down to where my dot finishes, right here. And then I'll go to the sewing machine, and I'm going to stitch from here to here. If you have a fixed stitch, set stitch, stay stitch, back stitch, any of those things, lock those in place. Because this right here, this one's going to be more important. This will be part of your seam. But we're going to stitch. And when we do that, it looks like this. and it looks like this. So let's talk about that taller bowl. The taller bowl, when we mark this with our holes, we've done our holes. Now when I go to draw my lines, I'm gonna grab my handy dandy 6-inch hemming ruler. If you've been sewing forever, then you know this thing. If you're not a sewer, if you haven't been sewing forever, this thing, they sell at Walmart. They sell it in those little kits. They sell them at Hobby Lobby, all over the place. They're cheap. But what I want to be able to do with this is set this. You've got to do a guesstimation. Is the bowl a whole lot taller? Do I want to make it an inch taller? Is it just a little bit taller? So do you see how when I slide this down, basically when I place this here, that allows me to go put a dot here. And then when I fold, I'm going to make it a little bit more. So, well, no, we're good. So when I go to fold, I'm looking at that blue dot. I look at up here again. I look from here to here. And then I want to make sure I see that blue dot. And when I go to stitch now, I ignore this line. I'm going to stitch basically from here to here. So what that does, and I don't usually draw this out. I wanted to draw it out so you all can see it, but I don't even really draw that out at home. I just stitch from here to here. That just makes it a little bit taller. Not a whole lot taller here. Honestly, what I've done is about an inch on mine when I have taller bowls. That extra inch makes it kind of just hug the bowl a little bit better. So you decide. Standard bowls are exactly what this template gives you. I took all my bowls and all the bowls that I've found, you know, at Dollar Tree and cheapy bowls, and compared those bowls to the bowls at home, and these lengths that I have here are pretty standard. It's only when you get to those taller bowls that you want to change that length. So we would stitch all of these, and when you do that, it's going to look like this. So the next step that we want to do is grab a pair of scissors, and with our scissors we're going to cut. Now this adds a whole lot of bulk, so we want to get rid of that bulk. When we do a final top stitching, this material right here, big time bulk. So we want to get rid of that. Don't trim it so close that you're worried about those stitches ripping out, but you'll go ahead and trim those off. So you'll have four of those and then you're all set. So we're going to do that to the top part and we're going to do that to the bottom part. One thing that you can do if you just want to ensure that you're going to be successful is stitch around here, right along the edge. So basically like here, just to lock everything in place. You can see this is stitched on here, but this is pretty floppy. When you go to stitch, the last thing we want to do is when we turn this right sides out is have this fabric twisted and looking ugly, and then we've got to go back and fix that. Especially at your corners here, where, not corners, but where your darts are, you'll want to stitch those down. So stitch all the way around. The next step is to turn one of these inside out. So we've got this one already set. We're going to take the other one. We're basically going to flip it like this, what you're seeing here. Line up your darts. Just kind of finger those. Give it a good press. And then we're going to pin or clip. So let me show you two options. If you've got straight pins, then I start at where we've done our seam, and then I go to the dart. And I usually go to the left of the dart. You can go to the right, whichever way you like. And then I would pin. But if you know Martelli Tools, this is a zip gun. Zip guns have zip clips. Go watch my video if you're not familiar with these. And we're going to grab. When I grab, and I grab these, I don't have to worry. Now you notice that's not on very tight. It's tight enough. We're good to go. These guys here are going to grab. When I grab with these, instead of having straight pins, they're going to stab you. This morning when I made some of my samples up, I stabbed myself and I had to keep making sure I didn't have blood all over the place. So instead of using these, the zip guns are pretty cool. Zip guns with the zip clips, these are all called the zip clips, they're reusable. So you'll see a video that shows you how to do that. So with the zip guns, these zip clips are going to really hold that fabric in place. And I'm going to show you a better way to put the clips on. Hold this down flat, grab my hand, my thumb. My hand goes underneath, my thumb goes on top. And notice what I'm doing here, straddling. And when I push, that locks that in place. These come right off. They go right back in, so they're reusable. So we'll grab. All right? So pins or clips, it's your choice. Next step is go to the sewing machine. When you go to the sewing machine, give yourself a space that you're going to leave open. You want to have a straighter spot rather than the curved, so that when we turn this, we'll have an opening to turn right sides out. So let's say I'm going to leave this open. When I start to stitch right here, we're going to put our needle down, lock that in place, remove the clip. Don't pull this way, but pull towards you. That clip will come off. And we'll continue to stitch, stitching all along. Again, because we've stitched, let me just show you that top stitching there. Because I've stitched that piece together and I've stitched this set of pieces together, I don't have to worry about that fabric flipping on me. So when I turn it, I'm not going to get that ugly mess. So we'll stitch all the way around. When we're done, again, we're going to turn this right sides out, give it a good press. Let me show you a couple pressing tools that are good to help you with that. All right, so we've stitched all along. We've left ourselves an opening. And when we go to turn, you really want to get in and push. You're going to have to push with your hands and just get inside there. And again, I wish I'd had a sample for this to be able to show. But just give it a good press when you're with push with your fingers. Then when you've got this, imagine there isn't any top stitching here. Then we just want to make sure it's really open. So this Sewmate, this tool, Sewmate, Seam Ripper, Stiletto, Embellisher, Applique, Paper Piecing, Crazy Quilting, Finger Pressing, Machine Ribbon Embroidery, and more tool. Don't worry about any of that stuff I just said. Just know it's a cool tool, because I have a video on this too. Go watch the video. But this tool, imagine that I'm just wanting this to be flat. You can push like this with your hands. Come over here and push like this. But when you've got those corners that are rounded pushed out, then you're going to give it a good press. And as you go, what that's going to do is really give this some good substance and good structure. And just, you notice how I'm just kind of turning this as I go. Then when you feel like everything is good, you're going to take a moment, and this is where pins work out better than those zip clips. Imagine I have that opening, and you're just going to tuck that in. You all have played around with that. There's no really great way to do it. Steam a seam, stitch witchery, peel off tape, permanent glue, washable glue, any of those things. I usually just finger it, and then I'll use my iron with this tool. Just again, you've given it a good press, and then you start to pin. You can pin this way, but what I tend to do, I'm left-handed, so this is awkward. You're going this way, here, to here. Right-handers, you guys definitely have advantages here. So imagine this part right here has not been sewn down. So I would pin as I go to stitch, pull out those pins, and as I top stitch, I'm closing that opening up. And again, you know the process, even though I've skipped this step, you know how that's done. If you've been sewing for a while, you know how to close that as you're top stitching. Top stitch along the edge, and that gives it a good, nice kind of a finished look. So let's take a look at these two again. And we've got a bowl that sits with the right length of the darts for us. And we're ready to go grab some soup, go grab ice cream, whatever it is that you want, with a nice microwave bowl koozie.
Okay, I think that's pretty much it. I hope this makes sense with this and the written directions that I have on my website, winterdesigns.com, on the extras page. You'll be able to go look at the directions there, download those, print them out if you need to, but they'll walk you through step by step with a little bit more detail than what I've done here. I also want to ask you to please go to my Facebook page. I have a Facebook page. I've done nothing with it. If you go like me, I promise I will do something with it, and I'll start putting pictures. I've had customers that have bought the microwave bowl template, and they have sent me pictures, and I can't wait to start posting pictures of theirs and pictures of yours too. So please go to my website. You'll see on Facebook, it's Facebook Winter Designs. And my goal is to have pictures, to have comments, to have feedback from you guys, and also to have specials. I'm going to offer some specials. I want to do some contests. I want to do all kinds of things that you're supposed to do with Facebook that I haven't done. So I'm going to try. So winterdesigns.com for more directions. Please email me or call me. If you're interested in purchasing any of this, you can see me at one of the trade shows. That's probably how you found me in the first place. But if you found me through YouTube and you don't know anything about this, I do classes at the trade shows that are always free. So you can come take one of my classes where I show you a whole bunch of other things too. If you know about the trade shows, you can purchase there. If not, you can purchase on my website. They're gonna be more expensive on my website. That's my phone. So you'll see them on my website. They're more expensive because I'm paying to be able to take credit cards on my website. So the best way to do it is you can send me an email, you can call me, or you can see me at one of the trade shows. I'm also going to hopefully have an Etsy website where you'll be able to purchase there too. let me know if there's anything you need. I'll be having more videos coming out soon. Thanks for watching and have a great time and enjoy. So one more big piece of news, at least for me, from my winterdesigns.com website. Nancy's Notions. If you all are familiar with Nancy's Notions, they just put in a big order. They are going to be selling the microwave bowl template. They're going to be selling my roundoffs, and they're going to be selling my coffee cozy. I just shipped, so go look on their website, nancysnotions.com. I'm really excited about that. So I want to show you one more thing too, besides the microwave bowl. This is just an afterthought. You're doing a Christmas gift, you're doing a birthday gift, you're doing a wedding gift. You're giving somebody some pots and pans. So use the same template. When you go to sew, don't do the darts. Do your stitch. Sew those two pieces, again, right sides together. And then when you turn, you're gonna have batting from the front and back. And you've got a nice stitch, and this will sit perfectly in between those really nice pots and pans that you've given as a gift. So they're not gonna get scratched. That's just an oh, by the way. Have a great time. Keep me posted on what you think.